Why did you leave string theory?
I was drawn to these foundational questions at the intersection of philosophy and physics. I was just fascinated by the problems that happen trying to make sense of quantum theory. I was dissatisfied with the interpretations and formulations that were available. And I got hooked, you know? You get hooked on something and you just want to probe it and understand and make sense of it. And I just found myself much more drawn to those kinds of questions. I'm particularly drawn to the kinds of questions that philosophers of physics will say is the kind of work that they do. We tend to be interested in the mathematical and structural features of our best, most successful physical theories, some of which are fundamental or candidate fundamental theories, some of which are somewhat more prosaic theories that describe everyday physics. We want to know what it is that physicists or more generally scientists are doing when they do science. We want to think about what does the success of these theories tell us about the structure of what's going on in reality. You can't do anything without some metaphysical posits. At the very least, that our experimental devices exist, right? I mean, there's some very basic metaphysical things that we assume to get things working. We have to assume scientific induction works, that we can take evidence of the past and use it to say something about the future. There's no way to justify that. I mean, back to David Hume, you know, hundreds of years ago, who pointed out that any attempt to justify that by using past experience is a circular argument, because if you say that induction is successful, we should believe in induction because it's worked so well in the past, then you're using induction to support induction. And there are a lot of people who've written about this. I know that you had John Norton on your podcast as well, and he's written a whole book on how to make sense of induction in his book, The Material Theory of Induction. So, you know, these are very difficult problems. You need something to get off the ground before you can begin to even do science. And philosophers of physics, philosophers of science are interested in those kinds of questions also. We're interested in what our best physical theories have to say about traditional questions in philosophy and in metaphysics. That's what I call physical philosophy. And at least some of us are interested in taking the methods and tools that one develops in analytic philosophy and philosophy of science and applying them to make progress on outstanding questions in physics. That's what I call philosophical physics, as opposed to theoretical physics or mathematical physics or experimental physics or applied physics or computational physics.
Right.
And trying to make sense of quantum theory, I view very much as a form of philosophical physics. We have a physical theory, quantum theory. There are places where it is either ambiguous or our other attempts to make sense of it run into problems of empirical adequacy or one of the other problems that we've talked about earlier. This is a physics problem. And it may be that the ideal set of tools to address it are the kinds of tools that Einstein was using when he interrogated the meaning of inertial reference frames, an interrogation that led to enormous consequences. His whole development of relativity comes out of him trying to develop a more rigorous understanding of inertial reference frames.
The tools being?
Tools of rigorous scrutiny, careful argumentation from as clear definitions and as clearly stated premises as we can formulate, looking for implicit assumptions that might not have been noticed, looking for connections, questioning standard assumptions, looking under rocks, metaphorically speaking, for interesting things that may be lurking under them.
Can you give an example of that? The looking under the rock?
Sure, yeah. So, I mean, in a sense, that's what Einstein was doing when he was probing the meaning of an inertial reference frame. I think one could very well have had an attitude back in the early aughts, not the 2000 aughts, but the 1900 aughts,
sure,
that physics was about the atomic theory, and it was about electromagnetism, and it was about thermodynamics. And here, Einstein wasn't trying to build new models of that kind. He was asking about the scenery, like inertial reference frames. Inertial reference frames, that's background stuff. That's scenery. That's not the protagonist of physics. But he uncovered that rock and out came relativity. So, I mean, that's, I think, a fantastic example of how looking under rocks can lead to new insights. We also look for connections between theories, connections that other people haven't noticed. I mean, this project came out of me trying to build a connection between the theory of stochastic processes and quantum theory. What kind of work is that? It's not the kind of work I think that we usually associate with theoretical physics, where you're building models within a given paradigm, or mathematical physics, where you're trying to take statements that physicists have made and prove them rigorously, turn them into theorems, or apply mathematics to physical problems, or develop new areas of mathematics inspired by what's going on in physics. You know, it's not experimental physics, it's its own kind of thing. Definitions, premises, building very, very careful arguments, uncovering hidden assumptions, you know, looking under rocks, building connections between things, analyzing the conceptual and mathematical structure of our best theories, understanding their moving parts. You know, spending time doing that is really exciting. And sometimes this leads to surprises. But scrutinizing, I mean, that's scrutiny is a particular methodology of doing things, right? We're not necessarily doing experiments. We're not just building models, which is, of course, you know, building models is a very important and very difficult and challenging thing to do, and obviously central to how we formulate physics. But taking things we already have and really trying to pin down all the details, trying to make sure everything fits together, there are no gaps and no logical problems. Trying to pin all that down is just a different approach. It requires a different set of tools, different inclinations. I mean, there are different people who like doing different things, who have different talents, different tendencies, different inclinations. Some people like doing one kind of work. This is the kind of work I like doing. And arguably, it has borne fruit for science. Last time we talked, we had a lovely discussion with Emily Adlam. And during that time, we listed many important contributions that have been made to physics that have come from taking that philosophical lens and applying it to our best physical theories, from EPR and entanglement to decoherence to quantum advantage, Bell's theorem, the no cloning theorem, the no signaling theorem, and arguably later work that you know is connected with things like quantum teleportation and quantum cryptography and quantum information. So I think there's a real track record of this being incredibly useful to science and worthwhile for people to work on and also for people to fund.
So I have a question about the interpretations of quantum mechanics.
Yeah.
There's plenty of hubbub about interpretations of quantum mechanics. But if it's already understood that the greater theory, the more fundamental theory, will be a theory of quantum gravity, furthermore, that the only or the most well-developed UV-complete, non-perturbative approach is string theory,
yeah,
then why isn't there more work done on the quote-unquote interpretations of string theory?
Yeah, so I would recommend that people look up the work of Nick Huggett, for example, a philosopher of physics who's given a lot of attention to trying to understand the philosophy, the metaphysics and philosophical questions surrounding string theory. I did some work with some of my colleagues, some preliminary work on string theory. We just had a lot of other things we were working on and we got pulled away from this. I think partly the reason there's been less philosophical work on string theory is because it's just newer than things like relativity and quantum mechanics. You know, relativity goes back over 100 years. Quantum theory goes back over 100 years. So there's just been a lot more time for people to think about these theories. String theory is of much more recent vintage. I think one issue is that string theory is still very speculative. We don't know that string theory is the confirmed best theory of quantum gravity. And I think that there's some reluctance to try to spend too much time trying to understand the metaphysical underpinnings of a theory that isn't substantially verified at this point. We don't have any real empirical confirmation of string theory at this point. I said before that philosophers of physics like to understand the mathematical structure and features and implicit assumptions and everything for our best, most successful physical theories. And by this, I mean theories that have proved the test of time, that have been empirically verified. Because the work that we do for those theories, we feel will stand the test of time. Whereas if you're working on trying to understand the philosophical underpinnings of a speculative theory that might not last, well, then your work on that might also not last. Now, of course, one could take the view that philosophical work, foundational work on string theory, may help move quantum gravity forward. And I think that may be partly what inspires people to think about these questions. But I would recommend that you interview some of the people who work on the philosophy of string theory. I think Nick Huggett would be an excellent person for you to talk with. I think you might get some insight, and you could ask him what motivates him to work on this theory. I think the other main reason why fewer people in philosophy and foundations of physics work on string theory is that string theory is mathematically very complicated. I worked in string theory during my during graduate school, and there are very beautiful features of string theory. I mean, you work on it and you see beautiful connections. It changes how you think about quantum field theory in really profound ways. I learned a lot about quantum field theory from learning string theory.
Right.
But it is a very mathematically intricate theory, and I think that presents an obstacle for a larger fraction of people working in philosophy of physics to work on it. Now, the people I know working in philosophy of physics are very mathematically sophisticated, but there's an investment in time that one has to make in order to be able to work on string theory. A bigger investment in time, I think, than may be the case for other theories people can work on. And so I think that's been a hindrance to more people working on it. But there are people who have decided to invest that time, and they've worked on it, and you know, it's interesting to know, you know, to think about what they've been able to see.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.